Hi, I'm Top Hat John, and welcome to Top Hat John's Motor City, the show where we talk to and about people and the automobile. Well, in this show and the automotive world, we wear a lot of different hats, and we're going to show you some of those. This is Top Hat John. We are at Clinton Township Television, CTTV, and we're with a wonderful guest today, a gentleman that's been around the automobile hobby and seriously as an instructor at the Career Prep Center and also at a high school in Warren that we will be talking about, none other than Mr. Frank J. Antonucci. He's helped an awful lot of kids, adults, get into the automotive programs and really succeed. He's also written a book, Being Cool in a Hands-On World. Wonderful guy, Mr. Frank Antonucci. We've known each other a lot of years. Done TV. How are you, sir?
Good morning. Good to see you.
Good to see you, Frank.
Big time here.
You know, I'm going to get right into this. This is way cool. You've been a lot of fun. I met you when you were the instructor at the Career Prep Center, teaching body work to kids.
That's correct.
Now, when I walked in the door, what did you think when you saw me in my three-piece suit and my gray car?
You walked in the door, and I seen you park your car by the shop. I said, uh-oh, 5-0, this is a cop, this is undercover. What did we do wrong? FBI, what's going on? You came in and introduced yourself, and you were a very good friend of our dear friend Larry Valentino.
Yeah.
And we hit it off right off the bat. My personality, we clicked, and little did we know, 40 years from later, we're still here.
Amazing.
God bless. Yeah.
I'd like to get into a couple of things. You were the instructor, and I'll just be real brief on this because we're going to get into it deeper after.
Yes.
You were the instructor at Career Prep Center, Body Shop.
That's correct.
What's the school about?
The Career Prep Center is located in Warren Consolidated Schools. It's part of our school system. It's an elective, and it's for those students that prefer to go into the work world and learn hands-on skills. There are 21 different programs, and the Career Prep Center is alive and well today. It's located in Sterling Heights, right on the corner of 15 Mile and Maple Lane.
Unfortunately, you had a bit of an accident that caused the problem. I think you went back and got 10 more PhDs after
that. Yeah, yeah.
And then went on to be the assistant principal at...
I was at Cusno High School. And then from there, I went back to the Career Prep Center.
You became the director there.
Director and the principal, yeah.
Phenomenal. There's a lot of things that you did in your life leading up to doing this book, being retired, and just keep on going. You're traveling all over the country doing some neat stuff. What prompted you to write your story?
I wanted to share my story with many people. I wanted to share my story with people that are just like me. As I taught those students that were in my program, I saw a mirror. And I wanted to share my story because those same students are out there today, the same kids. Nothing's different other than, you know, there's a computer and cell phones and so the technology. But those are the same kids struggling. And it prompted me. I had a story to tell, and I wanted to share it with everyone.
You're a good old Italian guy.
Yeah.
Hey, che passa?
Hey, hey. Hey, figlio, hey. Yeah.
What was it like growing up in an Italian home?
Well, yeah, Ed, you probably could relate to this, the viewers. Plastic on the furniture. No one sat on the couch. No one used the upstairs. We lived in the basement. You did not disgrace the family name. You did not disgrace the family name. You did what your dad told you. We had one phone, one car, and we lived in a 900 square foot home in St. Clair Shores.
And a one car garage.
One car garage. That's where it all started for me, in a little one car garage.
Your book describes you as your dad's helper.
Yes. My grandfather owned a poultry business in Eastern Market, Buscemi's and Son.
Mm-hmm.
And my dad maintained the fleet. And I remember when we lived on a street called Fisher in Detroit, after work, after his daily work, I would go out in the back and help him work on the cars, and or the trucks, the fleet. The one monumental thing that stuck out in my mind is when he added on turn signals.
That was that little box.
Yeah.
Most of them were chrome.
Yeah, this
and it had that little knob underneath, and it had the red light and the green light. Yes.
And
were they self-canceling then?
No. No, they were just, it beat the arm. And I helped him put them on, and he would call, my nickname was Skip. He said, Skippy, see if the left side's working, see if the right side. I had to ask him, Dad, what's left and right, you know? But I helped my dad, and my dad was very, very hands-on.
You described something, you mentioned your experience in elementary school, and you're a highly educated guy. I mean, you definitely got edumacation. You're in a field on your own, Frank. Elementary school.
Well, my mother, I was big for my age, and my mother and dad started me. I was in the first grade, and I was just turning 4 and a half, 5 years old. My birthday is in February, so I was in the first grade at 5 years old. I skipped kindergarten because we had moved from Detroit to St. Clair Shores, and there was a lapse. So kindergarten, the only thing I remember about it is eating crackers and going and taking a nap. But I'm going to in the elementary school, the subject matter was very difficult for me. And the teacher would walk around, do the lesson. This was way back in when I was in the first grade. And about 3 weeks later, I walked in the classroom, and all our chairs, our seating assignments were changed. And they had the A group, the B group, and the C group. And I'm looking, that's kind of strange. My last name begins with an A, and I'm in a C group. And here I am in a C group. The C group was for the slow learners and those that were less than normal, if you will, academically. So I developed a technique. From that point on, I laid low, I looked at the tile, and when she would walk around, we had female teachers back then, would walk around and ask questions. I never answered them, I didn't cause no trouble, and I developed that technique all the way through school.
You had something about Vincent. You said something about Vincent and how he affected your life.
My passion, in my book, I write a chapter on Vincent. Vincent was back in those days, diversity, as we call it today, there was this young man that came down to my house, and he was distorted. His face was distorted, his facial expressions, and he couldn't talk.
How old was Vincent?
Vincent, I'm going to guess, I was about 9, 10 years old. Vincent maybe was about 11 to 12 years old. I'm not sure.
And back then, 3 years, that's 3, 4 years, that's a big difference.
And he was big, and he had, you could tell he was getting into his teenage years because of, he had skin, his skin was breaking out and so on and so forth. But I began to communicate with him. And later on, I found out in those days, he had to be institutionalized. And they put him in a home. And I always tell a story and choke up on it. When his mother, his sister, came down and said, Vincent has been asking for you. I said, where is he? He's institutionalized up in Lapeer. And I said, he'd like to see you. Well, at that time of my life, I was like 14, mm-hmm. 15 years old. And all I was thinking about was Frank Antonucci. And I never went and seen him. And then they came down and said, Vincent died. And I felt like I really let him down because we had bonded so well. And I never seen a difference in him. And when he died, that left a long lasting, to this day, I regret the time that I didn't go see
him. Didn't follow up, yeah. What experiences? I remember I had a Detroit newspaper route, and I was over by Van Dyke and Outer Drive, Falcons, Geno Shobar.
Oh, yeah, Geno Shobar, yeah.
And I had two streets there that I covered right in our neighborhood. How I thought it was phenomenal, my first business. Frankie, you had a Detroit news route.
Again, I was big for my age. You were supposed to have a Detroit news route at 12 back in the day. The young man down the street broke into the substation, we used to call it, where you paid the bill and so on and so forth. He broke in, had to sell his route real quick.
And the old substation, most of the time back then, it was an old garage.
Yeah. This was a chicken coop on where 696 and 11 Mile come in.
Mm-hmm.
It's gone. It was at Owens Farm. So that's, he broke in thinking he was going to make a killing or something, but he had to get rid of his route real quick. I bought his route, and I bought it on the next street from me on Yale, and I had my paper route there. And in those days, and in the people say, don't walk on my lawn, put the paper in between the screen door. And you didn't give him no lip. You just, yes, sir.
You did it.
No, ma'am. Yes, ma'am. And I had every house on the block was my goal. And even the people that didn't take it, I gave it to them for nothing until they could take it. I pressured them. There, I met a car guy. I used to go by this house on Yale, and this guy had the coolest cars. He had 62 red Dodge two-door post car, big block. I don't know.
Probably a Dodge 330 with a 413. That's
They started up and the ground shook. 58 Impala, 348, 32 Deuce. I mean, he had it all there, all of it. And I'd go by every day, pedal my bicycle. How's it going? So finally one day I had the tenacity. Hey, my name is Frank. He says, hey, my name's Frank. Nice to meet you. And he was a car guy. And one day he says, hey, Frank, would you like to learn how to fiberglass? I says, fiberglass? He says, yeah, come in the garage. I want to show you something. Now, back in those days, we didn't worry about going into the garage of somebody we just met. It was a different period of time. He had a black and a red 56 Ford up in the air on a jack stand, right around the parking lot. Remember when they all rotted out?
Yep.
We fiberglassed that cloth and Bondo, and that was my very first experience with the connection with the car, doing any kind of body work. And from that point, I started fixing cars on my paper route. I had in my front saddle, my bag, a little drill, a grinder, extension cord, everything, and 56 headlights where they rust out in the front.
Yep.
The Pontiac around the gas cap. So I had two or three cars, a spray canned them, you know, with the primer. But I would do that and I would do it for nothing.
You know, Frank, it's like all of us guys that were interested in automobiles back then, we did something. I took the simple side. I did not maintenance on cars, but I would polish your car. I'd wax it for you. So that was easy, and that got it started.
Remember to Simonize?
Oh, geez. What, our family did that once a month. I remember it first started with Dad's 56 Buick Century, four-door.
Yep.
Green and white. Talking about cars, now you're getting into doing stuff. What did you do with your dad's, I think it was a 62 Ford that he had?
My dad had a 50, he had a 57 Fairlane 500 black two-door hardtop, 312 automatic. Nice car, okay? And he was getting ready, our family was growing, so he wanted to get another car. So the rocker panels were rusted and so on and so forth. And all the kids in the neighborhood loved that car because it was so cool looking. Okay, the 57 Chevy was hotter, but the 57 Ford was also cool back in it, the Fairlane 500. So I did some repair on it. He traded it in, and he brought home a 1962 four-door, six automatic.
Picador.
Oh, my God. Blue, not a Galaxy 500. It was just a Galaxy.
Just a straight Galaxy.
That one strip of chrome. Oh, my God. So I looked at it, and all my buddies said, what the heck happened? I says, I don't know. So what I did with my dad's car, my dad was very liberal with me on working with the cars.
What color was the car?
It was a medium blue metallic. So if you can imagine this, we put, remember Porter walls?
Oh, yeah.
Porter walls, which are the white walls, baby moons, chrome wheels. And my dad went for the program, by the way. My dad, you know, went for it.
Who paid for this?
My dad did. My dad got the chrome. He liked it. My dad was a car guy, okay? He was deep down inside, he was a car guy. the taillight lenses, we went to a place called Cadillac Plastic. Flat taillight lenses we put in it. I shaved it. All the emblems were gone. I filled all the holes in. He took it over to a painter at that time, Royal Brian Ford. I didn't paint. And they painted the deck lid and the fenders, spotted in the fenders, and took care of that. We went to, Montgomery Ward's? Monkey Ward's.
Yep.
He had red and white seat covers put on it. And, I mean, his car just punched. I mean, like, it was rocking. And it was still a six-cylinder car, but it looked cool as heck. And it was all shaved and everything. And the molding was approximately maybe an inch and a quarter wide, and it had a cove in it. The molding had the side, it was one strip. And what I did with that side molding is I took 3M Scotch-Cal, went to, I forgot where I got it, at one of the hardware stores, and right down the center of it, I put a blue to match the car accent. And I mean, it really, really looked good for the time period. So that was my first thing. And that six cylinder, I used to have the keys to it. My mom never knew. We drove it around the neighborhood. I was like 13, 14 years old driving my dad's car
cool
all over.
Friend.
Yeah.
Cool friends.
Yeah. Yeah.
Embarrassing moments at Lakeview High School.
Oh my God. I'm gonna look right into the camera, and I'm gonna tell you my most embarrassing, and viewers, this probably happened to you, may have happened to your children. So here I am at Lakeview High School. As I said, I started school early, and school was difficult for me. I wasn't intellectually developed at, you know, maturation. So I'm at Lakeview High School. And I look like, at that time, the Fonz. Okay, I had the hair, the duck, the waterfall, thank you. And the grease, the brill cream, the brush, I had it all, peg plants. I mean, I was like a stomping dude, okay? So I walk into algebra class. Math was always a tough subject for me. So I walk into algebra class, I walk in, our teacher, the teacher was about 5'3", perfect, you know, perfect blonde hair, all the posters on the board, everything. So I walk into class, and the only seat left was the left front, right by the window, front row on the front. So she's talking about algebra, teaching us algebra. And I'm thinking, man, it's a new school, 10th grade, high school. Now's the time to ask questions because my future depended on it. So I said to her, right toward the end of the class, she says, class, do any of you have any questions? That's a rhetorical question. I mean, come on, teachers, people. Do you have any questions? Yes. I don't understand A to B, B to C, and D to E. And she looked at me, and she stomped her feet in a real matter-of-fact way. You're too stupid to learn this. And the class just busted out laughing. And I'm thinking, too stupid to learn. Why would you tell me I'm too stupid to learn this? So I said, And I walked out in a you know, class, the bell rang. I walked out in a real cool Fonzarelli walk. You know, it had to be tough. I walk out, went down to the counselor, and got out of that class. And I learned from that experience, from that teacher calling me too stupid to learn that, that just shot me down. And as years later, all this stuff came and visited me 360 degrees. But that's what happened at Lakeview High School.
Working and learning D&W standard.
D&W standard, it was time to, D&W was right across the street from my house in St. Clair Shores. And it was time to say goodbye to the paper route, because here I am, the Beach Boys, Jan and Dean, the Crystals, the Ron, everybody's jamming. I had my cool little 8-transistor radio, and I listened to Lee Allen and Joel Sebastian and all these guys back in the day. So here I am, I'm getting rid of my paper route. So I sold my paper route, walked across the street, and applied for a job. And I said, I'd like to apply for a job. They said, what do you know about cars? I says, I know quite a bit. I said, but I don't know enough. So I get hired at D&W Standard. I'm working with this guy named Larry that was a mechanic. And I'm working in the back. And Larry, all he did was whistle, didn't say much. And he said, give me a 5/8 open-end box wrench. I said, okay, Larry, I'll go get it. I'm looking at his toolbox. I didn't know what a 5/8 open-end box wrench was. I didn't know they were labeled. And from that point, I brought him maybe a screwdriver. I don't even remember what I brought him. And he took that wrench and threw it against the wall and cursed me out. I will not say what he said. You know, I cursed me out. And it said, next time you don't know, ask me and I'll tell you what it is. And I learned from him. So from that point on, worked out real well. Larry taught me quite a bit. I really enjoyed Larry.
Like any kid growing up in Detroit or any place in the country, you're going to get into a little bit of trouble. You're going to do some things. I know what happened to you, Frank. I don't think we ever talked about it. The car that you had that you didn't like and something happened to it. I heard that it rolled over. But
yes.
You got tickets and you lost your driver's license.
I did it all. Thank the Lord I'm still here. Believe me, thank the Lord. Yeah, I did a rollover at 90 at 65 Ford Galaxy 500.
Didn't like that car.
Didn't like it, so I flipped that thing. And no matter what I did, it was a 352 three-speed. I couldn't make it go any. It was just a dog. The whole car was a dog. But back to your question. So I have a cherry 64 Ford Galaxy 500 XL, black on black, four-speed 390, Holman Moody parts on it, factory headers, bad to the bones. I lived two blocks from Lakeview. So I went home at lunchtime, picked up my car, and my mom said, where are you going? I said, I'm going to school. So we live two blocks, but I got to be cool. So here I am at lunchtime, 11 mile as a east and west lane. So I'm traveling west on 11 mile. I make the Michigan U-turn, and the kids are all out there having lunch. And I must have pulled a 5 grand hole shot with this. And I'm going, oh, slam second gear, and the car's going. And shortly after that, I didn't even get to Harper. I got pulled over by Officer Hanna. Officer Hanna is notorious for giving tickets, and he pulled me over. I got an excessive speeding, they called it. Excessive noise, an excessive speeding ticket. They didn't have the radar back then. This was 66. And I lost my license. I had to go to Mount Clemens for driver's training school, and my mother and dad says, we're not driving you to driver's training school. You dishonored our family name. The people, what are they going to say? My mother and dad always was worried about what the people were going to say. I don't know what the people are going to say. So I said, okay. So I hopped in my Ford, drove to driver's training school, and parked it and walked. I was crazy.
Your kids in the school loved you. You did a lot of cool stuff. You had cars in Autorama. They reference you as Mr. A. I remember the first time I came into the class and heard them calling you Mr. A. You had your car, your 64 XL, in Detroit Autorama, along with a whole bunch of other cars that later the kids helped literally produce and build.
The Detroit Autorama, I was in the late model conservative custom hardtop because it was a 64 and this was in 67, the Autorama. So it was a late model conservative custom hardtop. There were 23 cars in it, five trophies, and I took third place. And I did it, I was still 16 because the show was in January, of 67, and my birthday was in February. So I was almost 17, and it just blew me away. It gave me one experience that I would never forget. And when I became a teacher, I wanted my students, the ones that people have given up on. They weren't academic achievers, and I don't mean it disrespectfully. They weren't sports.
Part of life.
It was it.
It's what it was.
And I wanted them to experience that rush I had that we could do something with our lives positive and show the world what we can do. So yes, we did Autorama.
So you had a car in Autorama. You had countless automobiles in Autorama,
yes,
and awards that you had won.
Yes.
And television stuff that we had covered back years ago. a lot of your students, Frank, have gone on to be very successful in the automotive world.
Yes, 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 yes.
And own shops of their own.
We had a reunion in 2015, and it was unbelievable. We had people from Hawaii, all over the country came, and very nice success stories.
Nice party, I remember.
Oh yeah, well. You were there. You were part of the whole scene. Yeah. You were part of CPC. They said, "Hey, there's Top Hat," or they'd go to a show. "I saw Top Hat, Mr. A. How's he doing?" "He's doing good. He says hello." You know, so they knew you and they loved you too.
Well, you opened a lot of doors for me, Frank, just like John Moss did from Chevrolet and people from Chrysler and Ford. It was really great. We had fun. The thing you did, though, you went ahead and you wrote a book. And this book right here, Frank Antonucci, Being Cool in a Hands-On World. We got a couple minutes left here, Frank.
Yep.
Where can our viewers purchase this book?
It's on Amazon.com. You can purchase it at Amazon.com, number one, or you can go to Barnes & Noble. With Barnes & Noble, just punch in Frank J. Antonucci, and it'll pop right up. Amazon.com, you can picture it. Amazon.com, Frank J. Antonucci, Being Cool in a Hands-On World. It's a 5-star book. I'm very proud of it. And there's so much I could have said in the book. And maybe there'll be a part two, I'm hoping.
Mr. A, what's next for you?
Next for me is probably going to write a sequel to the book. Maybe it'll be like Godfather 1, Godfather 2. I don't know.
Maybe.
No, I'm kidding.
Hollywood movie?
Hollywood movie. Let's go. I did send a number of press releases out, so we'll see what happens.
Excellent. Frank, what a pleasure. This is good. We've done some wonderful things together through the years. We've done television together, and I'm glad to have you here on the show with us. And Frank Antonucci's book, Being Cool in a Hands-On World, is Lifelong Journey to Success. Mr. A.
God bless you. Thank you very much.
I love you, buddy.
I love you too, man. And you can't say you love your buddy. It's okay.
You got it.
Okay.
Thank you for being with us. We had a wonderful show with Frank Antonucci, and this is Top Hat John saying, see ya!